It's our last speaker for the day, Jonny Black. I met Jonny on Twitter a few years ago, just how things are these days. It took us about 2 years to meet in person. I quickly learned that once Jonny starts to talk about design sustainability, he's in his happy place. I've never met anyone more enthusiastic around the topic. So putting this event together, he was the first person I thought of. Jonny Black is a proficient typographer, print production specialist, and all-around visual wizard. He's a co-founder of Cast Iron Design, a studio focused on brand identity and sustainability. Jonny.
Let's get started. This is a quick disclaimer. It's the first time I gave this presentation. It's all from scratch. I've done a lot of presentations on sustainability stuff, but kind of the way I work, it'll be a little bumpy, you know, some weird pauses, that kind of thing, but I think you're going to like it. We'll see. I want to start off with a few thank yous. Who made this poster? Are they in this room? Anybody? Nice. You guys did? All right. Nice job. Thank you for making that poster. I did notice that they're made of upcycled materials. Nice work. I loved it. Thank you, Mark, for bringing me to San Francisco. Looking pretty cool with the sunglasses, but did a little digging. Found this photo. You gotta bring back that fro. My name's Jonny, spelled a little bit weird. In case you're in the back and you can't see me, I look like this. I usually start by going to my backstory, but I got a lot of slides to get through. I wanna kind of do it pretty quick here. Condense it into just a few slides. Pretty basic stuff, you know. Might be wondering about cut my own hair, you know, it's kind of difficult. Got favorite colors, pretty predictable. I got pet peeves like everybody else. You might have noticed that it said I'm vegan on there. It's true, I'll admit it. It's an issue that's important to me. I think it relates to this conference. A lot of you guys know that going vegetarian or vegan is one of the most impactful ways that you can reduce your personal carbon footprint, but that's not the reason that I'm telling you that I'm vegan. The reason is because I read this article the other day in the New York Times that said, according to one survey, vegans are viewed more negatively than atheists and immigrants and are only slightly more tolerated than drug addicts. I thought that was hilarious, so I wanted to include that in the presentation. Maybe just lower your expectations a little bit so that you'll be pleasantly surprised in the end. We'll see. Right now, we're in San Francisco, and that's here. I live and work in Boulder, Colorado, and if you haven't been there, I'll take you there. Let's zoom way in. Boulder's nestled in the Rocky Mountains. Great place to live, I really love it. It's known for its protected open space, outdoor activities, progressive people. And take a little bit further. Oh. That's me, right there. And that's my business partner, Richard Roach. And this is our office. Great place to work. Richard and I co-founded Cast Iron Design in 2010. This is sort of the founding email right there. We just kind of stumbled into it by accident. And we call ourselves a design and branding office, but we do a big variety of work. So I want to take a minute to show you a quick overview of the different stuff that we do. It's going to be a little visually intense. Let's see how it goes. We do a lot of branding. It's logo design and typography, colors, layout, all of that stuff, right? Sort of top level. We do some packaging. We've done projects for cannabis, for a brewery, and so on and so forth. Print and editorial, books, magazines, business cards. If you can print it, we'll design it. Environmental, all kinds of different signage, wayfinding. We did a moose in tile. That's pretty fun. Copywriting. This is just one of my favorite pieces that we've done for copywriting. Just mostly silly, stupid shit. That's our forte, what we have the most fun with. Motion design is another category. This is some work that I think is really great. We can't show it in our portfolio, unfortunately, but I can show you here. So that's pretty fun. We did a rebrand for Nova. Web design. We do in-house design and development, which is pretty unique for a studio of our size. It's a website for an architecture client. Photography, we just started doing it out of necessity for clients, you know, help them out, and then we got pretty good at it, and now we're doing that. Our motto as a studio is design for good, not evil. And which means we care about a lot of different things besides design. You know, everything from social issues, fair labor, equality, and our main focus in this regard is sustainability. Sustainable Design Studio, every time we bring that up, people are like, what is that? And we see it as three important areas. The first area is an office. Our office is trying to run a carbon neutral workplace. And this includes a number of different things. There is your commute and travel. You can bike to work, walk to work, get there, public transportation, use an electric vehicle. There's your energy use, and that is thinking about your energy use both in how much you use and what kind of energy you use. Are you getting it from renewable resources? There's the waste, thinking about your waste and how you can generate less of it. And when you dispose of it, how you can dispose of it in the best way. Purchasing and supplies, thinking about how we buy stuff for our office is a big thing that we do. You can find a lot of stuff, awesome stuff on Craigslist if you're patient. Talk to me about that later, I'm a pro. And trying to buy things as locally as possible. It's good for your local economy, but more importantly, buying local means a smaller carbon footprint because you don't have to ship it as far. And when you do buy things that are new, we make sure that they're made out of more renewable and less toxic materials. And so that's kind of the short list right there. But here's the long version of the list. If you're curious about this, I can send it to you. You're not gonna be able to read it, it's going real fast. But yeah, we just really get into it and do a lot for our office. But the office really is the smallest part of it. It's more about the biggest thing is for us is our output. So that for us is the work that we're doing, can influence consumers. So we start with being choosy about who we work with, the clients that we take on. We try to put ourselves in a position where we can turn down a lot of work that doesn't fit with our, doesn't align ethically and for everyone that's going to be different. The main part of our output and the eco output part of it is overseeing greener production on those things that we design. So this is a tote bag that is made with organic cotton, which usually is grown in Turkey. And this organic cotton is grown in Texas. And then even if it's woven, it might be sent off to the Philippines somewhere across the seas. And it's like the really, it's the distance that matters for this. And then it's printed in New Hampshire and cut and sewn. And then the label is made in Vermont. And we try to add some humor into it. So this kind of builds, so we're doing a really good thing, but it also builds value and trust with the consumers. But we'll get into more of that later. I got a few case studies to share with you. Last step is arguably the most important, it's educating others about sustainability. So, educators in the room, teachers, think about the impact of, if you integrate sustainability into your curriculum, the compounding effects that can have, right? Because those students that you're educating are going to go on and do those, work in their professional field. They might become teachers themselves, educate others, and so on and so forth. So it really has this outsized effect. I'll give you one example that was really exciting for me. This is got an email from somebody who attended one of these lectures, and they were working on a project and sent us the impact report that they created for a catalog that they designed. And if you're not familiar with the impact report, it's in this case, it's for paper. It is measuring the savings, right, in resources versus a conventional paper source. So they used a eco paper, 100% post-consumer paper, and this impact report was comparing it to a conventional paper and measuring the savings. And here's what that looked like. Turns out they just saved a forest, 3,740 fully grown trees. And 1,748,228 gallons of water. Turns out the project was for Walmart, hence the reason for the enormous savings. But when I read that, it just absolutely blew my mind. Just food for thought, right? It's really important. Here's an example of the way that we do that. Aside from lectures, we try to be as transparent as possible. If there's anything that we've ever done and you email us about it, if we don't already have it on the site, we'll tell you the sources, where we printed it, what material we used, et cetera, et cetera. So we have full transparency on our website and in the case studies. And so this is an example of that from our site. And we made this pocket notebook for designers that has a guide on why you should use eco paper. We see it as like a gateway drug, so to speak, into green design. And then it says why you should do it, but also how to do it and trying to break it down and make it easier. And by the way, I brought a bunch with me, so come see me after the lecture. I'll give you one. We can chat. So I think everyone in the room is sort of on the same page, so I'm going to keep this pretty short, but the question is, why should you give a shit? And when I was looking for visuals, I found this image, which I thought was pretty great, sort of summed it up. It's obviously a fake image, you know, Photoshopped together. But what's funny is that this fake image reminded me of this real image, right? This is a golf course with the fires going on in the background, just insane. It kind of, to me, it sums up the state that we're in. Our ignorance and inaction on climate change has to stop. And I think that design is a really powerful tool to help accelerate that change. So I'm gonna go over four quick case studies, each with a different angle. The first is an exciting project that we're working on that's currently in development using some cutting edge or futuristic materials. The second is basically the opposite, really just a simple reuse or upcycling of materials, you know, that you can start implementing today. The third is highlights using just resourcefulness and some common sense, sort of the nuts and bolts of green design. And the fourth is a more extensive, broad approach applying sustainable design principles to a variety of touch points under a single brand. So let's jump into that first case study here. Recently had the opportunity to work with Patagonia. We're actually working with Patagonia. They could fire us. We don't know. Who knows? But we're working with them right now on this project, and here's a little quick peek at it. It's literally in development, and we're still designing it right now. It's a really simple project. It's a recommendations map for the Boulder area, and you know, we're excited about hopefully it leading to other projects in the future. But because it's Patagonia, we knew they might be open to working with new and experimental, you know, sustainable production methods and materials. So we asked them, "Are you open to doing rad eco shit?" And they said, yeah, we are. We're Patagonia. That's a summary of the conversation. They're not that. They're great. So we got in touch with this company called Living Inc. We've been keeping an eye on this company for a few years. Anybody heard of this company, Living Inc.? I'll tell you what it is. So Living Inc. is started by two biologists in Colorado at CSU. They came up with a process to replace conventional petroleum-based ink pigment for printing with pigment made from algae. And that is some, I hope that's algae. I just Googled it, I'm gonna be honest. The algae they use is a byproduct of an existing algae production, specifically algae that's grown for food coloring, which I don't even know if they're using it for food coloring. It's pretty cool. Algae is an amazing organism. If you're not familiar, it eats sunshine and CO2 and produces O2 or oxygen. As a result, the production of algae ink is actually a carbon negative process. So really, really cool organism. There are different species of algae that have different colors. Here are a few of them. So they can get, right now they only have black, but they can get red and green and blue and yellow, all different kinds of colors in the future. And when I say futuristic, at the beginning of this section, I meant it both figuratively and literally. I just got this email from Scott from Living Ink, who said that they're in the final stages of dialing in the formula for the ink. So, you know, it might not even happen, but needless to say, we're pretty excited about it. So, moving on to the next one. The second case study is, like I said, really quite the opposite of it. It's the simple upcycling of materials, and it's a case study about our business cards. For years, we've done these really simple black and white laser printed cards. One year, we even created what we believe to be the world's smallest business card. It is really tiny. It's really just 8 business cards in one, and you just pull them off like that. And you know, when you hand that to somebody, it's not really the most impressive thing. They're like, "I'm going to lose this," and you know, it's pretty novel. So we wanted to kind of create a business card, a new one that reflected our, you know, our current you know, level of design and experience with the design. And we wanted to do it without using any new material. So that was our sort of prompt that we gave to ourselves. And it was a little bit harder than we thought what it would be. It took a while to do, but we had no rush. There was no deadline. We had the idea that we wanted to use make-ready waste. So make-ready is that thing in the middle, that big white stack of paper. It is the waste paper created at the beginning of a printing process. So when the press operators are literally making ready. And this right here, this pile of make ready, by the way, these sheets are enormous, 26 by 40. This pile of make ready is for a job that I did. The printers had a lot of trouble with it. I walked into the press check and I saw that and I almost cried. It's part of the process, and they do recycle it after use, but it is important. You know, it's like an important factor that if you didn't go to a press check, if you didn't study green design, you would never know that this is what's happening behind the scenes and how you can alleviate or fix that. So I emailed the print vendor. I wanted to use the make ready. I asked them if they could give me some of their make ready. His response, no problem. And I think it took, 4 months or something to get the paper we wanted, but we went and finally got the call, went and picked it up, and here it is. It's from another job, so I kind of have it. You can't see it on there. It's one of their clients. They printed something, and they printed it on one side, and the other side is blank. But so here it is. So we had a make ready. We wanted to use the clean side, the white side, for the front of the cards. And then for the back of the cards, we decided to use our screen-printed posters for the other side. And here are a few of those posters. So we had the one side clean white paper, and the other side would be our screen-printed posters. And here's what those look like when they're cut down. Pretty cool, lots of different colors. And to join these two pieces together, we basically just use what's basically Elmer's glue, really simple PVA put them together. And the end result. So then when it came to, we glued those two sheets together, and then when it came to printing, we asked our letterpress printer if they had any ink lying around. We didn't want to use new ink. We wanted to use something that would be thrown away, that's not really usable anymore, because we didn't really care about, you know, how perfect it is. We were kind of open to the variation. So we asked him if he had any ink lying around, and he found this super old, it says environmentally friendly ink on there, which is crazy, but super old ink that would have otherwise just been thrown away. The ink's about 20 years old. It has not aged well. It's a thick layer of dried ink on the top that we had to peel back. It's pretty disgusting, really. It's like almost like some sort of terrifying like brain creature or something. Thing of nightmares. I'm sorry about that. But so we used that for the black. And then for the other color, we didn't really use a color at all. This is a really simple technique called blind deboss. If you're not familiar, it's a letterpress technique where you hit the paper with a plate, and it just creates this impression, and it doesn't use any ink at all. So that's what that looks like. And the idea is that we don't really want people to call us anyway. So blind deboss, you can't see it very well, but it's our phone number, and the most important information is right there. So we designed with that in mind. And these are the finished cards. The next one is about all around efficiency. This is a case study for Whistling Hare Distillery in Westminster, Colorado. They are a craft distillery. They make craft spirits using locally and organic ingredients. And we did a variety of work for them, including branding, packaging, signage, print collateral. And we also did the naming for them, which was new to us at the time. And we did some naming research, and we learned that learned about the North American pika. They wanted to relate it to the outdoors. So we came across the North American pika, which is that little guy right there. And in case you haven't seen one, the pika looks like this. It's absolutely adorable. And how many people have seen a pika in real life? Okay, just one, okay. You'll see them scampering around the mountaintops here in Colorado. I don't know if they have them out here. But because they live in the mountains, they're extremely vulnerable to the effects of climate change. And sadly, their numbers are dwindling. The pika gets its nickname, the whistling hare, because of its little trademark chirp or whistle. And they use that to claim their territory. Here are a few fawns there. But the pika is surprisingly ferocious. A little bit later, they caught this footage. When it came to designing the packaging for Whistling Hare, the first thing we had to think about is the different styles of spirits and how those would work. Spirits traditionally come in a variety of bottle styles, a little bit shorter for whiskey, taller for vodka, and so on, which means that you'll need different label shapes to accommodate the different size of bottles. And usually that looks something like this. And we wanted to sort of maximize the efficiency of this part of it, so we came up with the idea to use one label size that we could use for every spirit. So not only does this reduce costs for the client, but it also minimizes waste because the printer doesn't have to change out the dye for each part of the process and rerun the new label, so it reduces the make ready and waste on press. So here's what that looks like as the full set. And you can see how that single size works. So really simple, kind of common sense stuff. So we also considered the bottle that we chose for the process during that process. Looking at it, we noticed that most of the during our research, we noticed that most of the competitors were using this bottle right here. And this bottle had this really thick base. And we noticed that, and we thought, oh, maybe this has some sort of function in the filling process and that kind of thing. But we also knew that like a heavier base is a bad thing in terms of the eco part of it, because it means that it would use more resources and material to manufacture and transport the bottle. So we talked to the bottle supplier, and we found this bottle. Looks practically the same, uses less glass, therefore it's lighter, and they both hold the same amount of liquid. And it turns out that the only reason for the thicker base, and I hate shit like this so much, is to make it feel more premium. Broke my heart. So lighter bottle is, if you compare them, about a third of a pound lighter, which is quite a lot, a third of a pound lighter than the heavy bottle. So we did some quick math. There it is. It checks out, trust me. It turns out that it saves 336 pounds per pallet. Which means less material used to make the bottle, less gasoline used by the delivery vehicles to transport the bottle, fewer CO2 emissions from burning the gasoline used to transport it, reduced materials costs because the actual bottle was cheaper, and reduced shipping costs because of significant weight reduction. So, really simple nuts and bolts stuff here, right? Just a lighter bottle, more sustainable, and it saved the client a bunch of cash. That's a win-win. And by the way, I'm showing you all these perfect images, but we're fucking it up behind the scenes. So that is Whistling Hair. And the final case study is more of an extensive one. This is for a company called The Flower Collective. They're based in Nederland, Colorado. They make cannabis products. Here's a look at one of their products. And if you're wondering, we did the photography for this. If you're wondering how that works, really simple, a few mugs, a few white mugs, a little bit of dry ice and some hot water. The cannabis facility, their facility is custom built. It's high efficiency, low waste facility. Their cannabis is grown organically, but because cannabis is illegal federally, it's not organic certified, but it is really good stuff. They're very conscious about how they, each ingredient they use and how it affects the environment and local water streams. So I'll give you an example of that. Here's an example of a local competitor's ingredient list, right? And that's pretty standard. And this is what they're feeding the plants to help them grow. And here's an example of the Flower Collective's ingredient list. So pretty stark contrast there. They let us go like super wild with the humor. This is an example of some fake ailment cures. Smudge glasses, tiny French fries, forgetting someone's name, forgetting your own name, undercooked quesadillas, persistent cow licks, tooth spinach, sideways bed sheets, Cheeto fingers, chairs that make fart noises, farts that make chair noises, saying you too to someone wishing you a happy birthday. Just absolutely fun stuff. And here's some of the work that we did for them. By the way, that shirt right there is hand-dyed by this 70-year-old woman in Netherlands, where the company's based. I think that's just awesome, fascinating. This is, we did a packaging tape for them. That is, I'm gonna show two examples of that, of the part of the case study. We did a lot of different things, but packaging tape is one of those things that's really simple. This is paper-based packaging tape. So, you can have a lot of different types of packaging tape. There's plastic, and paper-based ones are the best ones because they can be put on the box and chopped up as part of the recycling process and turned back into paper, right? So it's just the best option, and a lot of companies are using it, but usually when you see it, it looks like this. This is an example of traditional reinforced paper tape. Does anybody know why this the reinforced paper tape is bad? What was that? Has multiple materials, that's correct. So what the reinforced part of it is those fiberglass strands that you can see crisscrossing through it. The fiberglass can't be turned back into a paper. Fiberglass in the first place isn't a great material from an eco standpoint. And so we created this packaging type for them that is non-reinforced. And it is totally made up of paper and some simple water activated adhesive. And they don't need it for their product. They don't need the reinforcement because everything's so light. It makes a lot of sense for them. The next thing is an example that we did for them. We did packaging for their bubble hash. And one of the key things that we did for their bubble hash was they wanted to use a rigid box. And if you are familiar with rigid box versus the lay flat boxes, the rigid box is like what you buy an iPhone and it has that really thick paper kind of cardboard stuff. That really thick board that uses, and that board is really heavy. So the box that we designed for them, we wanted it to have that same premium feeling of a rigid board, but because it's these single ply paper sheets, it's really thin and really lightweight. So we designed this two-part box for them, and to seal it, we needed some way to seal it to protect it from tampering. And we used an adhesive label you can see on the side there. And we're going to take a minute to talk about stickers here, or adhesive labels. Every adhesive label or sticker that you've ever used is, unless you've used that last product, is flawed from an environmental perspective. Does anybody know why? Any idea? Adhesive labels, stickers, why are they bad? I'll tell you. The reason is because half of the material that comprises the adhesive label is destined for the landfill. And that half is the release liner. That's that little part right there. So most conventional pressure-sensitive adhesive labels feature two basic parts, a face stock and a release liner. So they're a little more advanced than this. They're got several different parts, but the most important parts are those two. And we did some research on this because we're like, there has to be something better than the conventional pressure-sensitive adhesive labels. And we found it. We found the world's only that we're aware of pressure-sensitive adhesive label that has a recyclable release liner. So that means it can be recycled. It doesn't have to go to the landfill. And when you have a new material like that, Bartlett touched on this a little bit, you have to make sure that it's going to be used properly. It's going to be disposed of properly. So we actually contacted our local waste recycler, and they told us how to dispose of it, and we communicated that with our client, and we can ensure that this product is being properly recycled. The release liner, can be recycled with corrugated cardboard, and it saves a shit ton of viable paper fiber from going to landfill and turns it into more paper instead. So these are just two kind of quick examples of and sort of the sustainable approaches in this case study, but I don't have the time to go over all of it because it's a lot. We did about 2 years worth of work for this client, and every single piece that we did was thought about from an eco perspective. I'm going to play a little video that shows you a few of those considerations here. By the way, this didn't have audio, so I just added some audio to it. From there. So That is all for me. I want to thank you guys for coming out and hearing my spiel. Make sure to give us a follow on some social media stuff. And if you want to stick around and come talk to me, I'll give you a notebook. Thank you, guys. Thanks.